So you're going to have these water tanks staggered all throughout the building at some regular interval. And what happens when this pressure vessel begins to weaken? It's starting to dustify. At some point, it's suddenly going to give way and the contents are going to squirt out. I think that's what that could look like. I don't know what this is, but that makes a lot more sense to me than a bomb. Turn off cell phones and two-way radios, blasting zone ahead. Rock quarries, you don't want to have, you know, an accidental detonation. So how are you going to wire up a big building and not have anyone using their cell phones in Manhattan?
You have a steel beam flying through the air, and it's dissolving as it flies through the air. It's turning to dust, and it's not hitting anything.
The building was not smashed to bits. So that's why pulverizing doesn't describe it.
No explosions, no heat, no flames.
Vaporization implies high heat. You would have seen the whole building glowing. People would have been blinded by the light.
It's very dense dust. It initially blocked out all of the sunlight, 100% of the sunlight, so it was pitch black. You come to the realization that these pieces of material are becoming dust. They're frothing up into dust as they fall.
And if you watch some of these pieces, you can actually see them turning to dust before they hit the ground.
It turns to dust.
That's amazing. That is amazing. I mean, just like a Star Trek thing. It just, poof, it's gone.
What we saw and what happened on 9/11 was something that we as the public had never seen before.
Let's talk about the toasted cars, because this is one of the most fascinating things for me.
Most striking area is West Broadway. Mm-hmm. It goes past Building 7 and goes north for several blocks. And every car along there was toasted. What I mean by toasted is it's toast, is history. Mm. Not necessarily burning being the cause, just you can't repair it, you have to buy a new one. You have to replace it. All the cars along that road were toasted.
This isn't just one isolated incident. Cars as far away as a quarter of a mile away were getting damaged.
You will see an image of the parking lot with the cars in a normal state, and then the next frame of the video you will see that the cars are still in the parking lot and they've been completely toasted. All right, so they haven't moved. How is this possible? This picture alone proves that the official story is false, and it proves that there are armies of liars and trolls trying to cover up this evidence that I'm showing you now. And these people should be ashamed of themselves.
Where that car park is, there's a sea of unburned paper in between that wasn't ignited.
Example of a dodgy car, right? We've got a car here that's half damaged and half pristine. If you like, put your hand over one half of it, it looks like a new car.
Yep. That's a pretty good picture, and we've got several pictures of that, different angles. And this, I think I'm pretty sure this is on FDR Drive. This car, which is about half a mile away.
Whatever happened to that car? It shouldn't have happened like that. So if it happened here, or it happened underneath the World Trade Center, it wouldn't matter. It's a...
You make a very good point.
These are the air tanks that the firefighters wear so they can breathe fresh air when they're in a smoke environment. They have extra tanks on their fire trucks. Those extra tanks were said to have been exploding at ground level. That's weird. And there's a lot of testimonies of those. There's one in particular by Rene Davila that is interesting. His boss asked him, was your vehicle destroyed? And he said, yeah, vehicle 219 was destroyed. Was it on fire? What? Was it on fire? Fire, we saw the sucker blow up. We heard a boom. His vehicle blew up.
It appears that there's something in the environment that has had an effect on, particularly on metal objects, basically.
Metal being more easily affected than others, but there's different types of metal that are affected more easily, like the door latches, the trunk lids, the door handles on the cars. Those were pretty easily destroyed quickly.
Graph that Dr. Judy generated from data from the Alaskan magnetometer readings. Got this peculiar thing.
It's haywire all day and right till 5:20 when the building 7 comes down, and then it just goes back to normal. So whoever did 9/11 had to be able to move hurricanes around and affect the Earth's magnetic field at the same time, like in a cave with a satellite phone.
Right. This is an amplified trace of the Earth's magnetic field run by the University of Alaska. During the events of 9/11, these things go haywire. You can see that this deflection of the Earth's magnetic field started around about 8:15, carried on and reached a minimum point at 8:46. And then it kind of sort of recovered and reached a maximum at that where that brown line is, around about 9:03, 9:04. It started just to go down again. Anyone know what happened at 8:46 on 9/11? It was when this alleged first plane struck. So, what does this mean, folks? Do you think that a plane crash can affect and make a hole in the towers, and it can affect the Earth's magnetic field as measured 3,500 miles away, which is where these instruments were? I suggest to you that, I put it to you that we're looking at something off the charts of your current experience and knowledge if you've not been studying some of this separately. We're talking about energy effects. All of the evidence points to energy effects, and none of it points to traditional explosives, nukes, bombs and thermite and any variation of that.
Hutchin effect, an explanation by Mark A. Solis, which was written in 1999. First of all, the Hutchin effect is a collection of phenomena which were discovered accidentally by John Hutchinson during attempts to study the longitudinal waves of Tesla back in 1979. The Hutchinson effect occurs as the result of radio wave interferences in a zone of spatial volume encompassed by high voltage sources. The effects produced include levitation of heavy objects, fusion of dissimilar materials such as metal and wood, anomalous heating of metals without burning adjacent material, spontaneous fracturing of metals, temporary and permanent changes in crystalline structure and physical properties of metals. Levitation is not the result of simple electrostatic or electromagnetic levitation. That's what John Hutchinson discovered in the 70s. One of the strange effects that Dr. Judy Wood catalogued was these weird fires. This is John Hutchinson's experiment of trying to reproduce the Philadelphia experiment.
What it shows is when he turns off his gizmo, then the boat lights up with weird fires. And the cars lit up right after the tower's demise. Not during, right after. As though it was right after something got turned off. This igloo cooler and the plastic trash can are not melted. The paper is not burned either on the ground.
Look at this top image. This top image is before building number 7 was destroyed, and we have this strangely mangled bus here, which is very peculiar. But if you look at the bottom image, the bus is even more mangled, and it's moved.
So it's been impacted by the energy. So disintegration and movement, which is the Hutchinson effect, isn't it?
We'll get onto that, but that's it.
Yeah.
So there you are. This is a side-by-side comparison, hours apart. You can see these effects are not the effects of explosives.
Yeah.
This is a degradation. It's not an explosive destruction.
Mm-hmm. Bent beams. That's a copper bar, 3-inch diameter solid. It's not hollow after one of John's experiments. That's a beam from the World Trade Center. I'm going through this quite quickly. This is all in the book, and I've got booklets and all kinds of stuff. It's plain as day. Plain as day when you see it, when the comparison has been made.
Notice there's no creases in the corners. It curls up like that, like at room temperature. And this is a video that hopefully will run. There we go. It wiggles back and forth.
This is a police car, as you see, NYPD. Is it parked that way, do you think, on 9/11? Here's John Hutchinson's reproduction. He was challenged, a $100,000 bet, to reproduce his levitation effect with this wrench by a chap called Ace Baker, who I've written about in my book. John did the challenge. He reproduced the levitation. Of course, Ace Baker never showed up. We've got a number of levitation accounts of witnesses.
South Tower came down, I was across the street. At 1 second I was running, and the next second I was airborne. And I lost my glasses, I lost my cell phone, I lost my pager, but managed to hold on to both cameras.
Mm. But it threw you for a block?
I was back down at Ground Zero last week and walked the area where I have a pretty good recollection of where I was and where I wound up. And it was just under a city block.
He's a New York Daily News photographer. He was levitated and carried a block. This is from Michael Macko. I realized I couldn't get out from under the collapse. I dove under the ESU truck that was facing north on the west side of West Street. I dove under that and waited for the building to come down. When the building did come down, I actually thought I was trapped and the truck was blown off me, pushed off me, I guess. It was not there. At that point, I was just really shocked and didn't know what was going on at that point. I didn't know. I was really, really shocked. So hang on a minute. It dives under this ambulance. The building comes down and the ambulance is gone. We've got recently discovered a stairwell B. The survivors in stairwell B. One of them describing coming down the stairs, and he's got one of these, you know, heavy hard hats on, and he hears the building coming down, and his hat starts lifting off, and he grabs it on. Excuse me, why would his hat lift off? What's going on?
It's this fused element of steel, molten steel, and concrete, and all of these things all fused by the heat into one single element.
And almost like a chunk of lava from Kilauea or Iceland, where they're very sharp but breakable shards on the end here.
Now let's think about hurricanes. What do they do? Well, Hurricane Andrew drove this too before through a tree. Piece of plywood. And with tornadoes, I'm sure you've all heard about straw through trees. It's not because they're flying fast.
NIST, when they wrote the technical reports about how the World Trade Center was destroyed, which they received over $10 million, they used a number of contractors. And two of them were Science Applications International Corporation and Applied Research Associates, and also Boeing supplied data. They all do research in directed energy weapons. SAIC are manufacturers of directed energy weapon systems or components. SAIC were in charge of Ground Zero security the day after 9/11. Another speciality of that company is, guess what? Psychological operations, folks.
You've looked at a lot of these effects, and basically you sort of say that, well, look, if you consider the whole body of evidence, it can't be explained by any of the other...
By any kinetic energy.